Everybody's happy, chatty, and fun time of year here. Merry Christmas. We have a lot to celebrate. We're going to just stand and sing together. It's the only way to get you to stop talking. Would you stand and worship God with us? Glory be to God.
To us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever.
The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish.
Story now proclaim Messiah's birth. To hear. Sunday they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Hands that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails from me.
We do look forward to that amazing day when we will see you. But we long to see you because you have already shown your love to us. God, thank you for sending your Son on the greatest rescue mission in all of history, to come after lost sinners like us, to come into our lives and our mess. We are eternally grateful. And we pray, God, that we could express that well together in this time of worship, so that you would be honored and glorified above all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, good morning. It is good to see all of you here this morning. Thank you for joining us. Glad you're here. If you're visiting or if you're new, welcome. We're glad you're here this morning. My name is Doug Betts. I'm the children and youth pastor here at the Beloit First Christian Church. And just a few announcements before we continue on. We'd like to remind everybody that a week from today is Christmas Eve. I know, the year went fast. A reminder on our services, we will have one combined service in the morning at 9 a.m. There will be no kids' church or Sunday small groups that morning. We are still in need of childcare for that morning. And then we'll have a Christmas Eve candlelight service at 5 o'clock next Sunday. And at this point, we won't be providing childcare unless, you know, God does something to change that. It'll give them an opportunity to share in that service with us. But a reminder for those. And then also December 31st, which is New Year's Eve, we'll have regular worship times of 8 and 10:30, but we will not have any kids' church, and there will be no Sunday morning small groups that morning also. We are needing child care for that day as well. Every morning, I don't know if you're familiar with this or not, but I say every morning. I need to stop saying every morning. Most mornings, between our two services, we have small groups or groups that meet throughout the church. There are a handful of them that meet, age appropriate for kids, and then we have adult groups that meet as well. And one that I'd like to point out that is going to be starting Sunday, January 7th, so coming up here next month and next year, will be a class called Discover Beloit First Christian Church. And I think, it's being fairly new, an intriguing class, but I think it would be good for, not just for those of you that may be new to the church. If you are new, what a great opportunity to learn more about, you know, who we are. But also for those of you that maybe have been here for a while and just need a refresher or would like, you know, some more solid ideas on certain things, you know, like our essential ministries. What exactly is it that we believe in certain things? And I think one thing that's really important is how can we make this church our home? And then how can we make it a place where we belong and we can grow and we can serve together? So that class will be led by Gary Allen and Carl Fugate, and it will take place in the Family Life Center South Classroom, which is the South Edition, clear to the south corner back there. If you need more information, there's some in the bulletin, or you can get with one of the pastors or with Gary or Carl. We'd like to encourage you to be a part of one of those small groups if you're not already. And there are a lot of other small groups that meet throughout the week as well that you can participate in. We'd like to remind everybody that this Wednesday will be our last Fusion for this year, and then we'll have Christmas break. We'll meet again after Christmas. Fusion is for our junior high and high school students. We meet on Wednesday nights from 7 to 8:30. This Wednesday, we're going to discuss part two of the question, why Christmas? And more in detail, not necessarily why Christmas, but, you know, why do we celebrate? But why did God, you know, plan? This was all part of his plan. Why did he do it this way? I think there's some interesting thoughts into that. I obviously don't know the mind of God, but I see how he works in some of those things. And so I know if it were me and I were God, I would have done it completely differently. So I'm sure that this is of him. I would also like to remind you that there's been some discussion as far as food and opportunities to feed students for both Fusion and Clash. That's kind of an ongoing situation. We'll see how that develops. Would love to see that come to fruition. I know there are a handful of ladies in the church that have been encouraged and feel led to do that, but I also know that that's quite a task. When we're talking probably roughly 120 to 150 kids on a Clash and Fusion night, that's a lot of kids to feed and a lot of things going on. So I would encourage you, if maybe you feel led to serve in some capacity, whether it's in the kitchen helping, cooking, maybe in a more of a donation type capacity where you could help donate time or food or whatever it may be, however you might feel to be a part of that, I would encourage you to pray about that. And then if you'd like to visit with that, I'd love to hear, because I think that could be a tremendous ministry to our students as well. So I want to encourage you to pray about that. Again, we do have needs in our Fusion junior high and high school youth ministries. Clash will be starting up here soon, which is our children's ministry. There's lots of opportunities for volunteers. God is doing some awesome stuff in our young people. And as he's brought more and more and more young people into our ministries, it's created opportunities for us as older folks to serve. So I would encourage you to pray about that. And then visit with me if you have questions. I had a conversation this morning before early service with a gentleman who kind of felt like maybe that was an area, but he wasn't real sure, and I could sense some hesitation. And I just told him, I said, you know what, Wednesday at 7, come hang out and see what we do and get a good feel for what goes on, and then we'll go from there and see if it's something you feel will work for you. So we'll talk about it. If that's you, I'd love to visit with you. And then finally, we do kids' church. We do have needs for volunteers there, but I'm excited about what God is starting to do for the new year for that, and where he's bringing some people in to help with that as well. But I would like kids' churches for any students who are in kindergarten through fourth grade. If we have any of those guys and you want to come up here and hang out for a second, we'll go up together to the youth room for kids' church. But we are going to talk about today, it's Christmas, so we're going to talk about Christmas. It's kind of appropriate, right? Today specifically, we're going to talk about how God chose Mary and Joseph to be his earthly parents. And then we're also going to talk about the birth of Jesus and how all that went down. So we got lots of fun stuff to discuss today. So I'm excited. We'll talk about that. If there are lots of other things going on, and I love that, we are involved, but we don't seem to be busy. Although I know that it's really hard not to be busy sometimes. I feel that way. So I would encourage you to check out the bulletin for anything else that you might be interested in.
As the calendar gets closer to Christmas, many folks are going over their gift list on what they plan to give different people. Of course, the early birds have already been done for several weeks. They've got their shopping done and everything's wrapped, and then the mid-range organizers are just now getting their plans in place, and then the late adopters, they haven't even started yet. We have lots of time to do this at the last minute. So there's a wide range of varieties of how you can approach gift planning. No matter where you are on your gift list planning, we can benefit by considering the things that the Apostle Paul had on his list for those people who were on his heart. As we prepare for our prayer time as a church family, I invite you to listen as I read Philippians chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, which says, "And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God." What can we learn from these words from Philippians chapter 1? In this passage, the Apostle Paul had a list of what he wanted for the believers at Philippi. He prayed for them at least four things. He prayed that they would have love. He prayed that they would have discernment. He prayed that they would be pure and blameless. And he prayed that they would have righteousness. That's a special list of character blessings from Paul's prayer, and we can pray that same thing for ourselves and for others. As we gather as a church family, that should be an inspiration for us. We already have prayer joys and concerns we shared in an earlier service that we'll include in our prayer time together, and we have cards that have been turned in with prayer joys and concerns that we would include. But we welcome the things that you would share right now, joys, concerns, and especially testimonies about what God is doing in and through your life and the lives of other people. Whatever's on your heart, we want to share it together as we pray as a church family. What would you share as a prayer, joy, or concern, or testimony? We welcome the things that are on your heart. Yes. Okay. We'll pray for them in the hospital. Other joys, concerns, or testimonies, whatever's on your heart, we welcome the things that you would share. I'm going to lead us in prayer. Yes, Phyllis. We'll pray for the family of Jim Nothern, who passed away. Sudden passing and unexpected, and they certainly need our prayers and support. Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute with a pattern of prayer following the letters of the word pray as an outline, P-R-A-Y, in which P represents praise, R represents repent, A represents ask, and Y represents yield. I want to encourage you to be praying on your own. I'll offer some suggestions. But pray on your own in your own heart, however God prompts you. As we start off our prayer time with an expression of praise, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, praising Him however He prompts you. We praise you, God. We praise you as God Almighty, as you are the only sovereign and holy one. You're good. You're our Heavenly Father. You do not change. You alone are eternal, everlasting, and exalted. We praise you with our lives. We lift our hands in your name, and we praise your holy name. We move on in our prayers to a time to focus on repenting. I invite you to talk to God in your own heart about your own life, however he prompts you. God, we pray according to the truth in Acts 3:19 that tells us, repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. Thank you for that promise that we can be forgiven. I have failed. I have sinned. I'm helpless and hopeless on my own. I know that I'm guilty. Therefore, God, I confess my sins. I repent and seek your mercy, washing, and cleansing. It's only by the blood of Jesus that we have any hope of forgiveness and cleansing. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it. We can't pay it back. It's just as we receive it as a gift. Thank you, Lord. We move on in our prayers to a time to focus on asking. I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, asking whatever he prompts you to ask him for. God, there's many joys and many concerns and many things to give you praise for, and we just want to thank you for the opportunity to come to you. We praise you for this Advent season as we prepare our hearts to celebrate the birth of Jesus. Help us to remember that you are the reason for the season. Lord, we pray along with Phyllis Behrens, for the Kibbe brothers, for Jimmy and Bob, as they both have health concerns. Be with them. Show yourself strong on their behalf and all that they need. We pray along with Keith Williams, thanking you for the giving opportunities he's had and for the need for many small churches in Northwest Kansas to have people to speak and share the truth of your word. We pray for an unnamed lady who recently was diagnosed with several small tumors, and she will meet with a doctor this next week for more advice regarding this concern. Be with her, we pray. Give her comfort and peace as she trusts you in the midst of this uncertainty. We pray along with Kay Heller, thanking you for a new grandbaby and her family tree, as Jonathan's family has a new daughter, Emerson. We do pray for a complication as a baby needed some extra help and is in the neonatal intensive care right now, hopefully to be released from that situation soon. We pray along with Rod Pearson as he expressed thanks and appreciation for the prayers and support he felt after he had a recent fall. Be with him, help him, strengthen and encourage him. Thank you for the blessing in Terry and Jean Nyberg's family as they have a new granddaughter, Lucy Maria, born in Manhattan, Kansas. Be with that part of their family and help them, we pray. We pray along with Dave Cordell for our president, for our country, for all that relates to the concerns that we have as a nation. We pray along with Phil Vetter for his son, Jesse, as he has a potential job and interview. We pray that he would receive favor in the sight of those who are making the final decision, and that you would provide for Jesse through this opportunity. We pray along with Tom Maxwell for those in the military, especially as they're separated from their families because of needing to serve during the holiday. Help them, we pray. We pray along with Drew Graben for the many folks who have been traveling and well travel for the holidays. Be with all that are traveling. We pray for Paul Whipple and his ongoing health concerns. Help him, we pray. Be with the need for rain that has been requested, and we do pray for the many firefighters who are involved in California to help with those who have needs. We understand there's over 8,000 firefighters working in that state. Be with them, we pray. We pray along with Phyllis Shelberg for her mom in Illinois as she has a declining health, a mass that's possibly not a positive thing, and that the medical people and hospice have been invited to help her. We pray that you'd be with that concern, we pray. We praise you, God, for Jaden Adams' decision as he joined the church family last Sunday. We pray you'd be with him. Strengthen and encourage him. Guide, guard, and direct him, we pray. We thank you for the church Sunday school Christmas program that we had last Sunday, for the many variety of ways that the Christmas story was told through that special event. We pray for Barry Muncie as he recovers following back surgery last week. Heal him and restore him. Protect him from complications. We pray for Jerry Hale as he had knee surgery and is in recovery now. We pray that you would help him and get him back able to do things soon. We pray along with Doug and Dina Best for their house in Bennington to sell soon. We just lift it before your throne and ask for your provision in that situation. We want to remember the families of those who have experienced the passing of loved ones, and we pray for the family of Jason Zier as his funeral was last Wednesday. Send comfort and peace, we pray. We pray for the family of Mary Gentry as she passed away last week. And we also pray for the family of Jim Nothern as he passed away yesterday. For each of these families, send comfort and peace and prompt our hearts as a church body, the body of Christ, as we sense you directing us how we can reach out and love and support to help those who have experienced loss. We pray for Pastor Cliff as he shares your word. Fill him, anoint him, use him, allow him to share truth from the scripture that will be meaningful and powerful to direct us on how we can follow you more closely. We do pray for your spirit to be present to prompt each one of us on whatever the next step is for us, and help us, we pray. We do want to follow you. Help us, we pray. We move on in our prayers to a time to focus on yielding. I invite you to talk to God in your own heart about your own life, however he prompts you as you yield to him. From Paul's prayer to the Philippian believers, I offer it as a prayer for us individually and for others we're seeking to encourage. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight. So that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless before the day of Christ. Filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. God, I yield to you to allow you to be born in the manger of my heart. I willfully decide to prepare room in my cluttered life for you to take up residence and allow you to rule in my life as Lord and Master. In every way in my heart, I welcome your presence, your influence, and your guidance. I pray all these things in the blessed name of Jesus, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen.
Good morning. We celebrate communion this morning. The deacons will pass the elements out representing Christ's blood and his body. We ask that you hold them until everybody's been served, and when they return up here and Lenny's finished, then we'll take them together as a family. If you're visiting with us today, you're welcome here, and you're welcome to take communion with us as long as you've accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's a recommendation requirement we have. In 1974, two wealthy Argentine grain traders and brothers, Jorge and Juan Born, were kidnapped by a far-left terrorist group. The ransom was $60 million. 9 months later, they were released after the money was paid. The $60 million paid in 1974 would be the equivalent of $293 million today, which is the most money ever paid for a ransom. But that's not the highest price I ever paid. Jesus paid the highest price
when he gave his life on the cross for us. Matthew 20:28 says, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. See, we have all been kidnapped by sin and needed a Savior to set us free. When the $60 million was paid for the brothers' release, there was no guarantee that they would be set free, but it was paid anyway. When Jesus ransomed himself for us, he knew that not everyone would accept his payment, and they would choose to remain captive to sin. Yet, he did it anyway. So as we take the bread and the juice, let us be reminded of his loving sacrifice. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the love you displayed when you gave yourself on the cross for our sins. Help us to remember that as we take this supper now. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank you, Lenny. Thank you. from the book of Matthew. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." We now have an opportunity to give back a portion of what we've been blessed with through our offering. I'll read from the book of Malachi 3, 8 through 10. "Will a mere mortal rob God? Yet you rob me. But you ask, how are we robbing you? In tithes and offerings. You are under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it." It is hard to imagine that we could rob God, the creator of the universe, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Is there anything we could steal from him that he couldn't have at his disposal? The answer is yes, his ability to bless you. Many misinterpret this verse. They think it's all about giving money and that God is angry when we don't give. On the contrary, God doesn't need your money because it is his anyway. When you fail to tithe, when you fail to give of your time, when you fail to serve him, you rob him of the opportunity to bless you. Like any good daddy, he wants to give you the moon, but it comes with a stipulation. You have to be faithful in what he has already placed in your care. If you cannot be faithful with a small amount, he knows you will not be faithful with a large amount. So be faithful in your tithe, time offerings, and in your service offerings, and do not deny God the opportunity to bless you. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the abundant blessings you've given each of us. We ask, as we give a portion back, that you'll bless the gift and the giver to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance. The stars shall applaud him with thunders of praise. The sweet light in his eyes shall enhance
Yeah, thank you, praise team, and good morning, church. Great to have you out. We are really appreciative. You decided, you took the time and the effort to be here this morning so we could worship together. That's a blessing for us, and we hope it is for you as well. We're going to take time to look in God's Word at this point, so if you have a Bible, I think you'll find it helpful to follow along. We'll also have the words up on the screen here, but today we're looking at Matthew chapter 25, and we're going to look at verses 14 through 30. We continue in the series here, our Advent series. And I'll explain just a little bit about what we've been through, because we're going through this chapter and seeing a number of parables. We'll look at this middle parable here, chapter 25, today. Verses 14 through 30. Let me read it, you follow along, and then we'll see what God has to say to us. Remember, this is God's Word. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another one 1 bag, each according to his ability. And then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more bags. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. And after a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." And the man with 2 bags of gold also came. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold, and see, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." And then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. "Master," he said, "I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown, gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here's what belongs to you." His master replied, "You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed? Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him. Give it to the one who has 10 bags, for whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. And whoever does not have even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Let's take a moment to pray. We're grateful, Father, for your presence here, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would teach us, speak to us in our minds, in our thoughts, in our hearts. God, make it clear you're able to do this, and you're able to overcome our inability to grasp you, to understand you. So, God, do your work now. We present ourselves to you with that hope in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we've tried to take this series, and basically the premise is really kind of what we've just heard sung so well, to have an anticipation of seeing Jesus Christ face to face, and to know that in a season we call Advent, which we think of as anticipation, you know, Christmas is coming and all of the anticipation that goes with that, really points to this greater truth that Jesus Christ did come into this world, and God broke into our world as a human being. But after he died and rose from the dead, Jesus Christ ascended to heaven with the promise, one day he'll come back. And so we live in this time between the times where we're waiting for Jesus Christ to appear again. We call it the second Advent. Advent means appearing or arrival. And so to wait in anticipation for Jesus Christ to come back. And the scriptures are full of texts that help us to understand what it means to wait. That it's not just an idleness, that it's not just kind of we gather every week and we sing some songs, but just kind of twiddling our thumbs until Jesus comes back and then everything will be fantastic. But the waiting is really a critical time. We started this series by saying that in 2 Peter, Peter said, look, people are, the whole idea of Jesus coming back is going to become a punchline. It's going to be a joke for a lot of people because they'll say, well, it's been over 2,000 years and he hasn't come back yet. Maybe you guys aren't really sure of what's really going to happen, but not to let that dissuade you, Peter said, but actually to remember that the reason that God waits so long in coming back is because God loves. That God in his patience, Peter said, his patience means salvation. The waiting is actually an opportunity for us then to reflect the same patience that God has in that we come close and near to people as God did to us. And I use that illustration of kind of like fertilizer, you know. We become fertilizer in people's lives because that works really slowly, but it does have a tremendous impact and effect if we will allow the life of Christ to come through us to them. But to be patient in reaching out to people to help them to see the truth of Jesus. So part of the waiting is this patient reaching out as God would call us to do. But then we looked at last week, the beginning of Matthew 25, a parable that Jesus gave to say, well, here's another angle on the waiting you guys should be thinking about when you're waiting for my return. Wait in the same way that bridesmaids or virgins, they're called in the text, would do in Jesus' time for a wedding, that they would wait for the groom to come to pick up the bride and then take the bride back to his house. And the bridesmaids, the virgins, were supposed to be torchbearers, light bearers, because all of this happened at night. And they had to be prepared with their torches and oil in order to escort the wedding party. And he showed us two examples, those who waited but in a lazy fashion and those who were very industrious about it. And we recall that this really reflects on the idea that it's about relationship, that if you don't care about the groom, you're not really going to try to prepare for them. You don't really care about reflecting poorly on them. But if you love them, if you know them, then you work hard at preparing. And the working hard does not create the relationship, but it does reflect if a relationship is already there. And so we say, in a simple way to kind of sum this, we say the gospel is opposed to earning. You cannot earn a right relationship with God, but the gospel is in no way opposed to effort. And there's a lot of work that goes into any relationship and certainly a relationship with Christ. So part of the waiting is working hard in our developing our relationship with Christ. But then today we get this other parable that Jesus says. Here's another aspect of waiting. And the waiting in this case reflects on a master who is going to give servants of his, slaves, but they're servants who work for him, that he's going to entrust money to them. Now, our text calls it bags of gold. Older translations call this the parable of the talents. So he gave five talents to one and two talents to another, one talent. And what it really comes down to, it's money. It's a form of currency. But if you were to take how much we're looking at, I don't know if you kind of got a picture of this. You're like, five bags of gold, how much would that? We're actually talking a master who has millions of dollars that he entrusts. Can you imagine? Somebody comes to you and says, hey, I'd like you to be entrusted with some money that I have. Well, what are you talking about? I've got a couple $1 million here for you. I want you to be entrusted with it. Wow, millions of dollars we're talking about. This master says, I'm going to go away on a journey. And this is reflective of Jesus, who's ascended. He's gone on a long journey. And what's going to happen to his servants who've been given, entrusted with his resources, his wealth? What are you going to do with it? So this is the picture for us today, is talking about investment, understanding this idea of servants who are entrusted. By the way, as an aside here, I got to say this. Don't get thrown when Jesus switches metaphors on us. I want you to be absolutely crystal clear about this, because some of you are like, the idea of being a slave to Jesus, gosh, I don't know, Cliff, or a servant to Jesus, that's in the scriptures in a number of places, but it's not meant to undercut this fundamental truth that we don't want you to miss. At the very core of the gospel is that what happens is Jesus Christ adopts us in as full-fledged sons and daughters of God, that you are a child of God. That's your identity. So when Jesus talks about that, don't miss that that's who you are. But when he talks about servanthood, he's talking about what you do. And so one way to think about this is, you and I are supposed to have the heart of a child of God, but we're supposed to have the hands of servants. That's the way it ought to reflect in our lives. So he's focusing on the servanthood, the doing here. What do we do? Well, the idea is that you are faithful. I mean, you can't miss that here. The best response from the master is that he gets two of his servants come back who've invested his wealth, and they've done well, and he says, well done, good and faithful servant. But I got to say, don't mistake that for, we do this with Bible stuff all the time. We hear of a characteristic and we think, that's a feeling. Like, to be faithful means I have faithful thoughts or ideas towards God, and that's not it at all. Faithfulness in the Bible is always, always an action. Love in the Bible is never just a feeling that I have for somebody. It's an action. It's the way I live towards them. You know, I've said this before, but it's a big pet peeve of mine, and it gets worse the older I get, so I don't know what's happening there. But one of my pet peeves is wedding vows that are not vows. Drives me batty when I'm my wife Laura, she likes to watch these romantic movies, and I watch them with her, and they're okay, but she watches these movies and Hallmark movies. They always kind of reach up to this point where they're going to get married, and then if they show the wedding, invariably it does this. It drives me crazy. But they'll have the two people, and the music is swelling, and they're looking in each other's eyes, and they'll start to say stuff like, you complete me. And right away, I've told you this before, enjoy movies. Question the theology, right? It's probably best not to question the theology while you're watching the movie, though, because I can't help it. I'm watching this, and I'll say to Laura, I was like, that's not a vow. That's not a vow to say, you complete me. It's not a vow when they go on and say, I've never felt this way towards anybody in all the world. I'm like, that's not a vow. Where's the vows and this wedding vow that they're supposed to be giving? And I go on and rant on like this until finally Laura's like, hey, settle down, preacher boy. I'm just trying to enjoy this movie right now. But that's the whole point. The point is, a vow is not a feeling. A vow, they never will do this, but this, I'm serious. Next people that ask me to marry them, I might write this into your vow, just so you are aware. I would love to hear a vow that goes this way. Honey, after we're married, when you get the flu and you get sick as a dog and you vomit all over the bedroom floor, I will be there for you to give you the bucket and the towel so that you can go ahead and clean that up. No, what does it really mean to be invested in somebody that says, I will be there, and I will be down on my hands and knees, and I will clean. Now, that's a vow. You get sick, I will be there to clean it up. I want to hear that in a marriage vow somewhere. Now, that's got some meat to it because that's the essence, really. Yeah, there's more to that one, right? Yeah, it's got some chunks to it there. That's the idea behind the Bible. When the Bible says love, it says don't worry about how you feel. Worry about getting down and serving. Worry about what you do. So when the master says, well done, good and faithful servant, he's not trying to say, I'm glad for all the time that I was gone that you had warm, happy thoughts about me. But you know what? That's what Christianity gets reduced to so many times. People think it's just about like thinking nice thoughts about God. Like, I'm pro-God, I'm for you, God, for you, Jesus. He's like, faithfulness is an action. It's what you do with your daily life, in and out. What are you doing to show faithfulness? What did they do? They invested. What does it mean to invest? Some of you do this for a living. So you're like, yeah, I work at this every day, Cliff, investing. Investing means basically, let me just break it down the way I see it. Investing means somebody gives someone else money. They give them their money, and the whole point of it is I'm going to give you this money so that you can do something with it such that I will actually get back what I gave you plus some. But here's that we always think from investment that side. Do you realize what that means on the flip side? Have any of you ever been invested in where somebody came to you and said, I want to give you something? So that, yeah, you can do something with it, but in the blessing is people who say, they invested in me. They invested in our company. They invested in what we're doing because why? I guess they believe that there's something worthwhile here that can happen. And suddenly on the other side, you realize when this master says, look, I've got tremendous resources. I'm going to give it to my servants. Servants, you in turn give it. See, to invest as faithful servants means we give what we've been entrusted to others. Now, some of you are like, yeah, and it's kind of risky business, Cliff. See, because investing, you hope you have a good investment, but you're never quite sure. Because I could give this to this person to use, but they might fail. They might lose it all, and then I'm out everything that I've invested in them. There's a real risk with investment. But ultimately, there's something great that can happen. If you invest and somebody says, where's this money coming from? And you say, I got this master. And he's intent not just on hoarding all of his resources. He wants to bless you. Yeah, but doesn't he get something out of it? See, and this is where some people's view of God, they're really struggling with a view of God where they think God is just one more person trying to get something out of me. And most of your life, everybody's got an angle, don't they? Oh, I'll do this for you, but I expect something back. And is God kind of the same way? And here's the beauty of God's investment. God says, I'm going to give this to my servants, and they are going to give this to others. And what God gets back is glory. When people realize, he didn't have to give us this. He didn't have to give me that. He wants the glory to be reflected back that he loves, that he cares, that he sees lives and he says, you matter. I'm going to invest in you. See, one of the great things that happens in this text is that we think the guy who's fearful, who buries it all, is kind of just worried he'll lose it. You know what the biggest problem with him burying the master's money is? That he is actually hiding, obscuring the glory of the master. That's the crime here. The real crime is that no one will know the generosity of the master because he buries it. No one will know that the love of this master is so great, he wants to bless the community because they bury it. The master is ultimately so wealthy, he's not worried about losing this bag of gold. But what he says is, you are robbing me of glory. You're robbing people of the blessing. And so ultimately, this is about revealing the blessing of God through faithful investment. And I think it comes down to two things: how you view people and how you view God. That's what you see in this text. Look at how we view people matters. It matters because we get jealous. Jealousy is a huge enemy of investment. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. And every parent said, that never works at home. You cannot do that. You can't give one kid 5 bags, another kid 2 bags, and one. You can't do that. You always have to do what? You got to even it out. You got to spread it out equally. And so this text right away in our culture kind of says, hey, we're about equality. We're about making sure it's all completely even. And this text goes out of its way. They all got different according to their ability. Like they all have different abilities. And one of the clear things about the gospel is this. Your worth, your value as a person is completely independent from your ability. Completely separate from what you do. Your worth and your value is secured. And at the cross, we say, the ground is completely level. So it doesn't matter if you're a king or a pauper. When you come to Christ, you are adopted in as a child of God. And you're identity and worth is secured that way. But that does not mean that we are all given the same, that we don't have different abilities, that in fact God didn't create you unique. See, the world is thirsting and hungering for equality, and rightfully so. But they think the best way to do that is to wipe away all of the differences, to kind of undo whatever is different between us, and then that will somehow secure equality. And the gospel says, no, equality comes because you are created by God, and that's why you're all equal. But God made you so uniquely different that some of you are given greater abilities or have developed greater abilities. God says, that doesn't matter to your worth, but it does matter to what you're going to do. And the question is, can you handle it if you're the two-talent person and sitting right next to you is the five-talent person? Does that bother you? Does that kind of stir you up? When I started playing basketball, I was in high school, and I started on the JV team. And I started at the end of the bench. And so there was a bunch of us that would sit on the end of the bench all game long, all season long. I mean, we rode the pine down there, and we just never got in, and it was bad, but you start praying weird prayers, you know, Lord, let this be a blowout. And by that, you usually mean, like, if we get way up by 20, 30 points, coach is more likely to put us in the game. And you even start praying, even if we get blown out by 20, 30 points, we're more likely to get in the game. And the amazing thing was, you start, you know, you just never get this opportunity. These starters get all the minutes. And then if we'd get in at a blowout, it'd usually be like the last 2 minutes, 120 seconds. And when the coach would call us at that point, Hagee, get in here. Get your group, you know, get the second unit. He always calls the second unit. Get the second unit. We got 2 minutes left. We're down 35 points, you know. Now, there's only one of two reactions you're going to have. If you've been waiting for your turn down there, and everybody else is always ahead of you on this. We had one guy, he had this kind of reaction every time. He said, hey, you're in. And he would mope. Oh, he'd be like, now? 120 seconds worth? What's the point? And he would go moping about. And the rest of us, though, we were so desperate. We were like, awesome, we're in. We're down 35. It really doesn't matter what we do. We can't do anything wrong. And so we would go out there, and for the 120 seconds, I mean to tell you, we were like wild men. I mean, we were diving for loose balls. Even when there weren't loose balls, we were diving for loose balls, crashing the boards. We're playing full court defense. I got a rebound one time, and one of my guys was so jacked up that he guarded me. I'm like, I'm on your team. What are you doing? And we're so excited to get in there. And it was awesome. And then on practice the next day, we'd come in after that game. And at practice, first thing, and you always, I don't know, I can't remember my kid's name, but I remember my junior high JV coach, Mr. Sheehan. He would start off practice. He would say, before we get going, he said, I want to just say something. Second unit, you guys were amazing last night. You crashed the boards, you pushed the tempo, you pushed the ball, you played tremendous defense, you were all over the place, you guys did amazing. It was fantastic watching you. I mean, when you're hearing that, you're just like, yeah, well done, good and faithful servant. And he keeps saying how great we were. I never occurred to me to ask, if we're so great, why don't you put us in before the last 2 minutes of the game? But it never kind of dawns, because at that moment, the comparisons didn't matter. Well, this guy's playing three quarters. I'm only playing one quarter. What's the when you can get away from comparing your life to other people and begin to say, whatever God gives me is amazingly glorious. And I know what this means on a practical level. It means some of you, the biggest prayer that you have to pray right now is that, God, I'm sorry that I'm mad at you. Because some of you are really, really angry that God made you the way he did. And every day, there's a kind of resentment that is just kind of there. And you look at other people's lives and you say, why can't it be like that? Why, God, this situation? Why does it have to be so hard for me? And it's really, really impossible to invest your life the way a faithful servant is called to do when you and I are constantly comparing our lives to others. God made you for more than that. But we have to be okay with who God made us to be. And then say, God, however you've, if it's one, if it's half of a bag of gold, whatever it is, I'm just going to take that as a great opportunity. That's what you see with these servants. But that's how we view each other. But here's the other aspect, how you view God. You get mad at God. God, why'd you do it this way? And maybe part of your anger is because you see God like the third servant sees God, which is, I know you, he said to the master. Hard, conniving, you squeeze people to get stuff out of them, what you really want, and you see an angry, hostile God. And I can guarantee you, if you're struggling to really want to serve, the first thing is not to try harder to serve. The first thing is you have to get a correct view of who God really is. You will never serve a God willfully, joyfully, that you fear. If you fear God, that basically all he's really after is to kind of jump me the moment that I mess up, you will never, ever be able to invest your life in a good and faithful way. You know, back in ancient Greece, somebody said we should bring this back for our political system. I'm not sure. They would have the Greek politicians, when they wanted to introduce a bill for a new law for the people, what they would do is they would gather the people, and the person in the city, the politician, was required to step up onto a gallows platform. And then they would take the noose and actually put it around their neck. And then they said, go ahead now, tell the people what your bill is that you'd like to create a law for. And they would then try to defend and kind of encourage people, this is what I want to do, this is why I want to do it. And then if the people voted yes, that's a good law, we want to do that, they'd take the noose off. If they voted no, they took the platform away. You're like, gosh, what kind of a system would that be, you know, if we had that? And some of you are like, that sounds like a great idea. We should probably do that. But we think about gridlock now. Can you imagine? How many bills do you think are going to come before the people when that's the scenario? Probably not real many, because they're thinking, I don't know if this is worth it. I have a real chance of just being stomped and killed. That's exactly the mindset that people have about God, because they say investing means taking a risk, and I don't know if I can, is that worth it? Because as soon as I mess up, some people think all that's all God's waiting to do is pull the platform away. And when in fact the scriptures are so clear on this, I love the reality and the truth of God's word that shows us people who are trying to seek after God and follow him, but he shows all of their flaws, all of their mistakes, all of their absolute flat-out failures. And you see people that, wow, they're a great, you know, kind of a picture of faith, but they mess up. Abraham, oh, I'll follow God, I'll go. And then next thing you know, he flat-out lies. No, that's not really my wife, it's my sister. And he goes places and does things that just absolutely are against what God wants, but God doesn't at any point just pull the platform away. God says, you've really complicated this, Abraham, but I'm going to work with that. And Abraham's worst mistakes, God in his sovereign power is able to work into his greater plan. Because what it does is begins to reinforce for Abraham, you know what? This is a God where it's safe to fail. It is safe to fail with this God. He's bigger than my failures. Moses does the same thing. David does the same thing. He messes up big time, has an affair, commits murder, tries to do a political cover-up, and God calls him to account, but he never says, let me just pull the platform away because you really messed up the investment. Instead, here's a God that you can say, he's going to call me to it. He's full of truth, but he's also full of grace. That's the only way the other two guys invest, because they know the risk of investment. They know it can go bad, but they must have some relationship with this master that says, yeah, but I know my master. I know that he's got grace too. I know that he has the ability to overcome what I might really mess up, and that gives me the courage, the desire to invest as a faithful servant all that he's entrusted to me. Your view of God is going to absolutely determine how you respond in this time of waiting for Christ. And lastly, this investment in Christ, your view of how you view other people, your view of how you see God, but what it leads to is this overflowing, and the thing I love about this is shared joy. Investment is a great way to share joy. Like I said, those who receive the investment get caught up in it. Those who receive the dividend of that get caught up into it. God gets the glory. All of this is meant to draw us together into this shared joy so that when the master says all of these fantastic things that he says, awesome job. In fact, look at each one of these. Well done, good and faithful servant. Absolutely tells us what this master is really worried about is not the money, not the stuff. He doesn't say, hey, let's start counting this. Let's make sure, let's have a counting party here. No, he says, well done, good and faithful servants, about my relationship with you. God is more concerned about you than what you can do for him. Do you know God that way? He is way more concerned about you than what you can do for him. Look else what he says. You have been faithful with a few things. That always gets me. Here's a couple $1 million. That's a few things. That's nothing. This master is overwhelmingly rich. He has more for us than we could ever possibly imagine. That's what he's saying here. You guys thought I gave you the whole store? Not even close. And then he says, I'll put you in charge of many things. I gave you a few things to be in charge. I'm going to put you in charge of many things, which means the best is yet to come. The reason we long to see his face and we sing these songs and worship him, oh, one day face to face, is because the best is yet to come. As good as it can be to understand and know his grace now, how much better when we see this master. And then the master says, come and share your master's happiness. That's what it comes down to. I want to spend eternity with you. And I know there's a fearful warning at the end of this parable. Just like the other parable. Remember, the bridesmaids, the virgins were shut out. The door was closed. Here, this servant, no, take him out where there's darkness and gnashing of teeth. It's Jesus saying, please don't miss the most important thing. This life, and it may be really brief for some of us, but whatever hours and days and years you're given, this life matters for eternity, because what you and I do in relationship to this master matters for eternity. And he tells us these things not to put us in a state of fear, but to say, there is a way out of that. There is a way through it with me. Come in relationship with me. I want you to share in my happiness for all eternity. And I think on a practical level, this is the way it looks. When you get a disciple who gets that, I think it looks a lot like this story that Daniel Meyer shared. He wrote a book called Witness Essentials. And he writes of a true story of a widow who was about 80, in her early 80s. Older woman who's widowed. And the question is, what has God entrusted to this woman? What in her life could she look at and say, the master has entrusted me with this? But she is a follower of Jesus. She loves the master. She knows the master. And she says, you know what, even in my early 80s, I'm not done. I still am in this waiting period. God, I want to serve you. So how best to serve God in my situation? So she began to take stock of what had been entrusted to her. And she realized, well, for one thing, I have the gift of hospitality. That's something that she loved to do. She loved to have people over. less and less people as the older she got, but she realized she had that gift. She also realized she had been given the gift of time. And she realized that she had been given the gift of location because she lived in a larger city that had a large university that was right near the apartment where she lived. And as she's praying through this idea of how can I become a faithful, a good and faithful servant, even to the end of my days, this is what she felt the Holy Spirit prompting her to do. She decided to take 3x5 cards, and she wrote on all of these 3x5 cards the same thing. She wrote, "Are you homesick? Come to my house at 4 p.m. for tea." And she put her phone number and address on the 3x5 cards. And she took these to the campus, and she posted them everywhere. And she said, it wasn't like this mad rush of college students who want to go and have tea with an 80-something-year-old woman in her apartment at 4 in the afternoon, but she said it was kind of a small trickle. There were a few students that came, and she said she realized right away one of the reasons they came is because they were homesick, that this was not where they grew up. And to have someone who cared enough to invite them in, college student, hey, free tea, that's something, we'll go. And she said they started to come. And over the course of 10 years, God continued to allow her to minister to students with a little tea and a little Jesus at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And she passed away. She was in her early 90s. And at her funeral, they had 80 pallbearers. They were honorary pallbearers, 80 college students who showed up for her funeral. Because they realized here was somebody who took something that God had entrusted to her, and they blessed them, and they recognized it, they connected it. The master got the glory, because here was a woman who made it clear, this is from him to you. Is that the way our lives are structured? Is that the way our lives are aching to say, today, I don't care how little it is, I know that my God can be glorified if I will invest it. Let's pray. Okay, Lord, we thank you that your word is clear. We know that our hearts get cloudy, though, that we have lots of fears, that sometimes we still don't see you correctly. So, God, we pray that by your Holy Spirit you overcome that. Show yourself as the true God, the one in whom we were made to live and move and have our being, that we can trust you, and that you have entrusted us with life and breath and gifts and talents and abilities and resources. And God, we want to not bury those things. We don't want to hide your glory from people. We want to show them clearly that you are the God who has come to save. God, would you do that through us? Challenge us. Yeah, you got to get us out of our comfort zone on this, God, because there's relationships that we are hesitant to enter into. But help us to have the courage of your Spirit to do that well, to do that so that we can hear as we see you face to face, well done, good and faithful servants. That's what we really long for. We pray that happens as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we'll keep worshiping here with this closing song. It's a great song. It reminds us of his coming. But at the same time, as we sing, if you feel the Holy Spirit prompt you, we're going to be available at these doors. Just come on out and share with us whatever it is that you need to pray about. It's a privilege for us to pray with you. We'd love to do that. Otherwise, would you stand and let's worship God today.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. These are the days of Elijah. Days of your servant Moses.
like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.